A woman washing herself, and he shouldn't have been there, she shouldn't have been there, I don't know exactly what, but you know, when he first saw, he shouldn't have, you know, he should have turned. That's what he should have done. Turned away, said, whoa, this is not the right place to be, this is not where I need to be. And we need to do that kind of thing. You know, whether it's with a television button, you know, turn the thing. Computer, internet thing, turn it, shut it off, do something. But just don't look at that kind of thing. So, you know, we've got to be careful about that. Sin came to David by the way of the eye, which of course is what happened with Eve. She was told to look at that fruit, and she saw that it was good, you know, good to eat, pleasant to the eye. And a lot of times our sin, you know, we see something, we say, yeah, we could handle that, we could do that, that'd be fun to do, and not a good thing. Okay. And then of course his lust. We have a tendency to wish that we didn't have spiritual battles. Isn't that true? We all would like that, to not ever have spiritual battles. That'd be a great thing, wouldn't it? But unfortunately, they're always around. We cannot get away from them. So they will find us, even if we try to retreat. So I sent my daughter an article, because she has this this intrigue, if you will, with you know, this interest in hermits. And I get the New York State Conservationist magazine, and they had an article in there about the hermit. You saw that in there. Yeah, very interesting. Yeah. So here this guy lives in the Adirondacks all by himself. He's the mayor of the town of one, and he's the mayor. And yet, I'm sure there he has temptations. You just cannot get away from it. You know? Just can't. So it's better to be weary in the battle than to become apathetic, you know, get caught off guard. You know, be weary in it, not weary of it. Amen. You know, we're in a battle. We're in the Lord's work. If we know Him as Savior, and of course, we just want to keep doing His work. First Peter chapter 5, verse 8 talks about our adversary, you know, the devil, going about seeking to devour. You know, he's like a roaring lion. Talks about all those kinds of things there in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. You know, we're supposed to be sober, be vigilant, because our adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. And if you, in your neighborhood, wherever you live, let's say the police said there's, you know, a burglar breaking in, you know, in your neighborhood, wouldn't you be a little bit more vigilant? You know? You'd make sure the doors are locked and all that kind of thing, and you'd get your assault baseball bat and put it next to your bed, you know, so that you'd be ready, right? So, you know, you'd try to do something. You'd be sober, you'd be vigilant, you'd be, you know, earnest about it. Well, guess what? Satan's after you all the time. You don't need the police to come around and tell you. You really don't even need me to come around and tell you. You know, he's after you all the time, and he's trying to devour you. He's a murderer. And if he can, he might not be able to put you in hell because you've trusted Christ as your Savior, but he'll do anything and everything he can to ruin your joy, to stop your testimony. You know, he wants you to go around, well, yeah, you'll trust Jesus as your Savior. It'd be a real good thing for you. You know, who wants that? Amen? You know? Yes, David? Back there?
Well, let's see. Sometimes I'll say, you know, when homosexuals came out of the closet, I think many Christians took up residence there. And they're not in the fight.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not sure how much Satan really wants to mess with them. If
he can get you to where you're not doing too much, then he leaves you alone. Tries to keep the lost from you, but yeah.
When you have anything to tell anybody, why?
Right.
I'm sure the Holy Spirit would be working on a person in that condition if they're truly saved.
Yep. We do have that tendency. Of course, there's some man over in Afghanistan that's going to be executed for being a Christian, and no lawyers will defend him over there because he's a Christian.
Is it the fault of the Tea Party by any chance?
I didn't understand.
The Tea Party got involved in that?
I don't think they have yet.
Can't blame it on
them? I don't think so, no. Of course, over there, do they have the Tea Party or is it the Poppy Party over there? I don't know what it is over there. But for being a Christian, for being a Christian, standing up for Christ. Then we take a look at David's pride here. And remember, when it comes to lions, they're in a pride. That's what they call. They're not a herd. They're not a flock. They're a pride of lions. And the devil, gets us with pride. Every sin can be traced back to pride. Somewhere or other, our pride's gotten in there. When we worry about things, we're too proud to let God handle it. It always comes back to pride. That's what it does. David attempted to hide his sin, amen, because of his pride. And, of course, that ugly part inside of deceit rose up in him, and he tried to hide all of that. Of course, that kind of thing still goes on. There's nothing new under the sun, the Bible tells us there. And, in Ecclesiastes, it says nothing new under the sun. They still try to do this. And then we're all shocked. Oh, that came out. Oh, well, yeah. nothing new. So, of course, David, to try to hide all of this, brought Uriah home off the battlefield and tried to get him to have sexual relations with his wife so that everybody would think that the baby was Uriah's. And I don't know how much David looked like Uriah, but you'd think, after a while it would. Boy, he sure looks like one of the sons of Jesse, doesn't he? That wouldn't have been so good. But Uriah, being an honorable man, said, if my general isn't, my leader isn't having the luxuries of home and a soft bed and all that, I'm not going to. David even tried to get him drunk so he would do it, but he still wouldn't. He was that honorable a man. And what a man, really, Uriah. So here's the letter to his general there, to Joab, and he writes to him, wherever the battle's the hottest, put Uriah right there at the front of it, and then tell everybody, but not Uriah, that you're going to sound a signal, and everybody's going to retreat. And there's Uriah fighting them all by himself. And as nice as Hollywood portrays those kinds of things, the end still is death. So he dies. And what a terrible thing for him to do. But this is all part of the cover-up, say. So he dies. Now David can take her as his wife because she's a widow. And now he's thinking, isn't this great? The king takes her to be wife. But then people start counting. Now my grandmother always said this, Kitty, the first baby in a marriage can happen 1 month, 9 months, doesn't matter. After that, they all take 9 months. But the first one is, isn't that sad? But they start counting. They go, wait a minute. They've been married, only 6 months and she's had the baby already. We don't think logically, do we? When we're trapped in sin, we just don't confess it. We don't think logically. David's not thinking logically. You know, he should have confessed it all and you know, begged forgiveness from Uriah and all that kind of thing. And, you know, but that's not what happened.
Well, thinking if he had been honest, maybe Uriah would have divorced Bathsheba.
Oh, that's possible.
Or maybe.
Yep, that's possible.
This guy maybe have done like that one guy did and knew his wife no more.
Right, yep, yep. So, well, so David, who was called a man after God's own heart, is now the man who's grieving God's heart. That can happen to any one of us, me included. Yeah. Unconfessed sin. And just a terrible thing. Verse 26 and 27 of chapter 11, 2 Samuel says, "And when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. And when the mourning was past, David sent and fetched her to his house, and she became his wife and bare him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord." Emphasis. Right there. It displeased the Lord. So he's trying to make it all look good, you know. Yeah, but it's not working out. Here was a fella, Gary Richmond, a former zookeeper, said this: "Raccoons go through a glandular change about 24 months. After that, they attack their owners. Since a 30-pound raccoon can be equal to a 100-pound dog in a scrap, I felt compelled to mention the change coming to a pet raccoon owned by a young friend of mine, Julie. She listened politely as I explained the coming danger. I'll never forget her answer. 'It will be different for me.' And she smiled as she added, 'Bandit wouldn't hurt me. He just wouldn't.' 3 months later, Julie underwent plastic surgery for facial laceration sustained when her adult raccoon attacked her for no apparent reason. Bandit was released into the wild. Sin, too, often comes dressed in an adorable guise, and as we play with it, how easy it is to say, 'It will be different for me.' The results are predictable." Boy, I tell you, I was with some friends in Lafayette, New York, and they lived out in the country a ways, and we heard a commotion out back. They had a dog. It was a black lab. The dog was like maybe 11 months, 12 months old, just about a year old. And we went out there, and the dog was fighting with a raccoon, and the raccoon killed it. I mean, just tore its throat right out. No problem whatsoever. You know, the dog was lots taller than the raccoon, you know. It killed it, you know. And at first the owners thought, well, we'll get it to an animal hospital or something, and there's just no way. That raccoon just killed it that quick. And so you have to be careful with the raccoons, amen?
I think it's like when someone wanted to train a raccoon, I mean, you can, in their eyes, it's like, you don't see much intelligence. I mean, they're rodents. It's like they got those dark eyes, like they, you can't train them.
Right.
It's not like, say, cats or dogs or animals that you can actually see the window that you can communicate in.
Right. Yep. And apparently you can only train them, you know, because Walt Disney's used them in a movie here or there, but only until they get, you know, this age. And then, yeah, they're a wild animal. Yeah, they are wild. Well, take a look with me, David's losses. Okay, I think we're caught up now, aren't we, class? Yep, David's losses here from last time. And David suffered a lot of things. And these were personal losses because of this journey of sin that he went on. Instead of a journey of faith, it's a journey of sin. And he suffered greatly here. Yeah, great and personal losses. Okay. The greatest loss, of course, was his fellowship with the Lord, where I read just earlier about David, that the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. You know, that's a terrible thing, isn't it? Get out of favor with God, that's a terrible thing. I'm going to be preaching about that this morning, the morning message. So the loss of fellowship, and a lot of times we forget that. You know? In 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 1 through 6, we read this. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds. Now, of course, remember, David was a shepherd, so, boy, that picked his ear up. He understood what that meant. But the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished up. And it grew up together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup and lay in his bosom and was unto him as a daughter. And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was come unto him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. And he said to Nathan, as the Lord liveth, the man that hath done this thing shall surely die. And he shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity. And of course what we know is that verse 7, and Nathan said unto David, thou art the man. You're the rich man that took the ewe lamb. So he suffered a lot of consequences here. And you notice that he said in verse 6, and he shall restore the lamb. What's it say there, class?
Fourfold.
Fourfold, doesn't it? Fourfold. And watch what things happen here. The fourfold tragic events that came about as a result of his sin. First of all, there was the death of the infant. You know, Bathsheba had the baby born, but, you know, the baby doesn't live. There at verse 14 of this 2 Samuel 12, howbeit because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. Yeah. The enemies round about were saying, ha, 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 David serves that God. Ha, 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 what a God that is. You know, that's no God. Yeah. And the baby's going to die. Death of the infant. Here the baby's born. We know that Scripture, and we go through this passage, we see that David, you know, he repents and he's fasting and all that kind of thing. But, you know, the baby died. Anyhow, the second thing that we see here is that Ammon, David's son by one of his wives, rapes Tamar, his daughter, by one of his other wives, so a half-sister. In 2 Samuel chapter 13, verses 1 through 12, we won't get into all of that, but there was, it starts out there in verse 1, and it came to pass after this that Absalom, the son of David, had a fair sister whose name was Tamar, and Amnon, the son of David, loved her. Now, they're half-sisters. And, you know, so he doesn't know what to do. Of course, he asks a friend there in verse 3, what a friend. You know, the friend says, well, pretend you're sick and tell your father that the only one who can really make you feel better is Tamar. And when she comes in to care for you, then you can have her. Yeah, you can just rape her there. What a friend. You know, sometimes your friends tell you the wrong things. Now, whatever your friends tell you, check it against this book. Amen? You know, would this book ever say to lie like that? Would this book ever say that it's right to rape somebody? Never. You know, never, ever, ever, ever. But we listen to friends. You know. That's not always a good thing. Friends can get us into trouble. And you know, so it goes on here that's exactly what he did. you know, he laid with her, and of course then, you know, what a time, you know. And, you know, she's Absalom's full sister. And so from that time on, Absalom hates Amnon. I mean, he's got a hatred for his half-brother like you wouldn't believe. And he just stews about it, you know. And he doesn't understand, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, I will repay. He doesn't understand that. So then, of course, the third thing that we see is that Amnon is killed by Absalom. In chapter 13, verse 28 through 29, we see there, now Absalom had commanded his servants, saying, mark ye now when Amnon's heart is merry with wine, and when I say unto you, smite Amnon, then kill him, fear not. Have not I commanded you? Be courageous and be valiant. And the servants of Absalom did unto Amnon as Absalom had commanded. Then all the king's sons arose, and every man gat him up upon his mule and fled. They all wondered, who's Absalom going to kill next? But Amnon is killed by Absalom. Now David's got a mess on his hands. His family's a mess. Of course, it's not good because he's got so many wives to start with. That's not a good thing. But now his kids are doing all these things. Wow, what a mess, right? I mean, he should have reprimanded Amnon himself over the rape with Tamar. But he didn't, and so Absalom takes care of it. Well, then what we see is that Absalom is killed in a battle. Absalom rebels against David, and Joab then eventually kills him, even though David said, do not kill the boy. You know, you go to the battle, but don't kill him. You know, and when he dies, remember, he's mourning, and he just cries, Absalom, Absalom, my son, Absalom, oh, Absalom. You know, and of course they come and say, you know, look, the way you're mourning, you're gonna discourage the troops, because here they went and fought against your enemy, and you're making it sound like they all did the wrong thing, and you wanted the enemy to win, and so Absalom there is killed. You know, he's got to return it fourfold. You know, he kills Uriah. And he loses the baby. He has his daughter Tamar raped. And then, of course, Amnon is killed, and then Absalom is killed in chapter 18. What a price to pay, huh? His losses, great loss. Yeah, he had the loss of the fellowship with his Heavenly Father, but he's got all these family losses, personal losses, and they're tough. I mean, that had to be tough on him, you know. And even though he repented, you know, he repented way back here before the baby died. He repented way back here, you know. His consequences of his sin just kept going and going, going, you know. And we're talking, by the time Absalom dies, we've got some years in there. Yeah, David?
Well, his cover-up failed.
Well, yes.
I mean, the enemies knew. That meant everybody in Israel knew.
Everybody knew.
The whole thing. It's like, yep. One of those magazines.
Yep. Yep. They had tabloids back then. That was the front page. Yep.
Yeah. It's lasted to today. It will always be part
of
God's
yes.
Word.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
It's always there.
Yeah.
Let's show David's humanity too, I think, because, you know, we
yes.
have sin, we have that nature and
yep.
the propensity for it.
Right. Even though he was called a man after God's own heart.
He
you
could
know?
Really submit to God, and he could be a really bad sinner, so mm-hmm. he's
yeah.
showing ends that people shouldn't go to.
Right.
He was human, he was real.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was,
yeah.
Tempted with a lot.
Yeah, praise the Lord. His sin's recorded for everybody. Mine isn't.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Mine's washed under the blood.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
Yeah. In Galatians chapter 6, we're reminded here in verses 7 and 8. Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 and 8. We're reminded, be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Yeah, we talk about young fellas sowing their wild oats. Guess what? They're going to have to reap some wild oats. Amen? You can't. Yeah, there's some consequences sometimes to sin. There really are. And we have to understand that. You know, we'll have trials and temptations along our journey of faith. It's inevitable, amen? You know, it is inevitable for us to have that. But we need to respond by fleeing from temptation. Okay? To continue advancing on our journey of faith, we must respond by fleeing temptation and trusting God during times of trial. Just flee. Just get out of there. Go do something else. Change it. Do something. Okay. David's triumph. All right. This wasn't his motorcycle. Or his sports car. Amen. Remember, they took the word triumph and put it on their vehicles from the Bible. Amen. Even though he suffered immensely, you know, he was able to experience triumph once again. And he was able to do that. In 2 Samuel chapter 12, even though we had, the account of Nathan coming in and that kind of thing, we still see that he could have some triumph. The baby dies and all, yes, I know, but there is still some triumph there. Verse 13 of 2 Samuel chapter 12, and David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin, thou shalt not die. You know, and he really should have died for that. You know, for the adultery, they would take the adulterers and stone them to death. You know, and then he murdered Uriah. I mean, he didn't actually take something and do it himself, but he basically murdered Uriah.
He thought it up.
He thought it up. Oh, yeah.
Well, in a legal manner, he wrote it down.
Yes.
Now you got witnesses.
Oh, yes. Sure, yep. Yep, he should have died, but God forgave him. Mm. Yeah. You know, I should have been in hell first time I sinned. Mm. God should have struck me dead right there and threw me right in hell. I deserved it. You know, but he didn't. His mercy is enduring, amen. So we had this righteous confrontation, and I kind of went over it earlier, but, you know, God sent Nathan to expose David's sin, and, you know, sometimes people do come along and expose our sin, don't they? You know, do we often thank God for them? We ought to. So, of course, he had that illustration that he used with that one little ewe lamb, and you know, you can train a sheep to be that familiar with everything. You know, I get the picture that, you know, he's eating a bowl of oatmeal and he sets it down there and the lamb comes over and eats some of the oatmeal, you know, and he's got his cup of water there and he sets the cup down there and the lamb drinks right out of the cup, you know. One time I was camping out in Colorado and they had squirrels. Here I am sitting there and I'm eating my oatmeal. And a squirrel comes up on the table. He comes right over and he smells the coffee that I had. And he made a face at that. Then he smelled the oatmeal and took a chomp right out of it. So I'd take a spoonful, and he'd take a chomp. I'd take a spoonful, he'd take a chomp. I thought, that's pretty neat, you know. Then the next morning, I wake up to all this noise. I mean to tell you, it is a battle royal going on. I forgot and left a bag of Lorna Doone cookies out on the picnic table. And the squirrels and the blue jays are trying to kill each other over them Lorna Doone cookies. I mean, they are good cookies. And I mean, they're just, I'm just after each other. So, of course, you know, they got a mess out there. Well, you know, when I came out, they all scurried away. But I take that Lorna Doone cookie and I put it down. So sure, the squirrel will eat that. Then I put it on my arm. The squirrel came up on my arm. I thought, that's pretty interesting. So I had flannel shirt on, put the cookie in my shirt pocket in front of the squirrel. I mean, the squirrel's sitting on my arm. He sees the cookie. I put it in my shirt pocket. He sticks his head right down in there and gets it. You know, I thought, could rip up my chest. This is not smart on my part, you know. You know, so the lamb, can you picture that lamb, you know, right there and sleep with him, curl up with him, little ewe lamb, and, you know, eat from him and everything. Wow. Yeah. God's mercy, so evident in David's life. Amen. He did deserve to die. According to the law, he did deserve to die. His mercy. Oh, how we praise him and thank him for his mercy, his grace, his long suffering, his gentleness to us. Just incredible. In 2 Samuel chapter 12, 1 through 9, of course, we had that. That account, and then David's repentance there. And where Nathan says to David, start there again at verse 7, "Thou art the man. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel, and I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul. And I gave thee thy master's house and thy master's wives into thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would moreover have given unto thee such and such things. Wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon." And just kind of incredible. Leviticus chapter 20, if you would. If you take a look back there, in Leviticus chapter 20 and verse number 10. Leviticus 20:10 says, "And the man that committeth adultery with another man's wife, even he that committeth adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death." That was what God's law was. Boy, if they enforced that today, there'd be about, 3/4 of Americans killed. They'd be executed. Yeah. You stop and think about that. They wouldn't have any TV shows, would they? Man, oh man. You know, just incredible. I don't watch any of these shows, but you know, you're watching the news and they've got the ads on, you know. What really could be the plot of Desperate Housewives? I have no idea. Except adultery. Yeah, that's all it can be. Well, I mean, I just... And from what they show you in just the little clips before, you know, while you're watching the news, that must be what it's all about. I don't know.
Think that could have made it in the
1950s? I don't think so. Father's knows best, you know. Yeah, of course, I just said that, and half my audience didn't know what I was talking about. Yeah. All the young people in the room are going, what in the world is he talking about? A father knowing best, not in today's Hollywood image. Fathers are all dummies, idiots. Yeah. They're all bumblers.
Mothers know best.
Mothers know best, yes. Kids know better. Yeah.
One friend of mine said he thought Homer Simpson was stupid until he's seen some of the cartoons now.
Yeah, I would think. They're very, very stupid. Yep.
Yeah. That was just a good guy.
Well, he makes a real confession here at verse 13 and 14. We read there, and David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin, thou shalt not die. You know, what if he had said, well, I didn't kill Uriah. The Ammonites did. You know, I didn't kill him. Yeah. What if he'd have said, well, it was Bathsheba's fault. You know, if she hadn't been naked up on the roof, I wouldn't have sinned. Yeah, we have a tendency to want to blame somebody else for all of our... He just said, no, I have sinned against the Lord. You know, right there at that verse 13, you ought to put Psalm 51. Now, you just read through Psalm 51. Against thee and thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight. You know, he says, Psalm 51, that great confession that he makes there. Verse 14, howbeit because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. And so... You know, he's done these deeds. He's not going to get off scot-free. He is going to receive a lot of mercy from God, but not get off scot-free. So he called his sin out for what it was and called for David's repentance. And with a broken heart, David confessed and repented and sought God's restoration. And he put it all down in Psalm 51. And then... You know, and he says in Psalm 51, you know, restore unto me the joy of my salvation. When we're out of sorts with the Lord, when we're, you know, then we don't have the joy of our salvation anymore. And he needed that.
Pastor Ben.
Yeah.
The spot where he says, I have sinned against the Lord, that was short, it was quick.
Yeah,
and it started a process of restoring him.
Yes,
and his fellowship with God right at that.
Right at that point. Yeah.
So didn't take. He didn't have to do all kinds of things. He owned up to it.
He owned up to it.
Yep. Quickly, as soon as it was brought to his attention,
yep.
It started the Lord's intervention to really restore yep. him at that point.
Yep.
And to get him to pen what he was able to pen in
yep.
Psalm 51.
Yep, yep.
There's like a plea bargain he made with the Lord. It's like you're still going to serve kind.
Well, yeah, I mean, what you reap, you're going to sow. I mean, that's
well,
part of it.
When he said this, he didn't know he
right.
deserved to die. He knew.
Yes,
that.
Yep. When he first said that, yes, that's exactly right.
The Lord knew that because Nathan's first response was,
Thou shalt not die. Yeah. Thou shalt not surely die. Yeah.
He knew he should have died as soon as he said
that. Thou shalt not die. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yes, David?
He was having mercy when he didn't allow the boy to live. That would have been a son that grew up that would be part of whatever, the kingdom.
Oh, yeah.
Everything up.
Oh, yeah.
You don't know what kind of things would have gone on with that son. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What people would have said about him and all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, they said of Jesus, we know who our Father is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, that was throwing that at him. Yeah. You can't prove your birth. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Yeah.
The purebreds, how can you tell it?
Well,
that's a little bit pompous.
Yeah. Yeah.
Samaritan were part Gentile.
Yeah. they're half Jew, half Gentile. But yeah. So a restored kingdom that we see here. You know, God preserved David's life and continued his kingdom. See, God had made promises to David. They'd give him a kingdom forever and that kind of thing, even though he sinned. You know, and this good reminder for us that when we trust Christ as our Savior, we don't lose that. You know, now we can lose the fellowship with God in our sin, but we don't lose our salvation, because God's promised that. You know, God promises something, he comes through. Amen. He's faithful. That's what we know about him. In 2 Samuel chapter 22, verses 1 through 4, we see here David's got a psalm written down for us. It says this, "And David spake unto the Lord the words of this song in the day that the Lord had delivered him out of the hand of all his enemies, out of the hand of Saul. And he said, The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, the God of my rock. In him will I trust. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower and my refuge, my Savior. Thou savest me from violence. I will call on the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies." And, you know, he's just excited about great things that God's done for him. Well, let me just conclude for you here. Three words summarize David's journey. The first is trial, and of course Saul is involved with that. The second, temptation, and Bathsheba is involved with that. And the third one is triumph, and repentance is involved in that. If you want to put somebody's name there, you can put Nathan. God used the prophet Nathan. You know, he was able to triumph because he repented. In our trials, seek the Lord. In our temptations, flee Satan. It's the only way you're going to have any victory, any kind of triumph yourself. Okay. It's quiz time. Ha ha ha. It's Sunday school, right, Miss Kitty? Isn't that what they call it? Sunday school. So in a school, you have quizzes. Yeah. Here we go. Here's the first one. What was David's initial response to his trial with Saul? And my quizzes are comprehensive, too. They go back, and we do these lessons for weeks. And
He ran.
He fled. Let's see what the answer is. He fled. He also was discouraged, right? Didn't he get discouraged about that? Figured, you know, he's going to die at the hands of Saul. You know, he got discouraged about that. Okay, here's the second question. What did David do when he experienced defeat at the hand of the Amalekites? 1 Samuel chapter 30.
Encouraged himself in the Lord.
Okay. The pastor's wife says he encouraged himself in the Lord. Do you think she's right? Let's hope she is. Ah, yes.
I didn't cheat either.
She didn't cheat, she says. No, she didn't cheat. She went to Bible college, but she didn't cheat. Hey, why did David lapse in 2 Samuel 11, 1? And you can...
He wasn't out doing what he should have been doing.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Well, not with the troops. David tarried when kings go to battle. Isn't that what Scripture said? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that he tarried still at Jerusalem. Yeah, wasn't doing his duty. Yeah. Okay. When David's trial was at the hand of Saul, with whom was his temptation? Kind of a tough sentence there, but...
Kill Saul?
No. Bathsheba, Mary got it right. There you go. Okay. What should a Christian do when faced with temptation? Huh? Get some running legs in there, you know? Do a little fleeing. Exit stage left. The old, I can't remember which character used to say that, but.
It was left. We never exit left.
We always go right, don't we, David? Yeah. Yep, that's the scripture says.
The thief on the cross was on the left side. I don't think that was too bad.
I don't know.
He went to heaven.
Yeah, we're to flee temptation, right? What were the results of David's sin?
Lost three children and one daughter.
Lifelong consequences.
Yeah.
The
sword wouldn't depart from his house, but yeah, we've got there. The four of those things. The baby died. And Tamar raped. Ammon killed. Absalom killed. Yeah, what a time that he had. God spared his life, but he had consequences. He reaped what he sowed. We have to.
Yeah. Thinking he didn't give any thought to him, the consequences.
No, we don't. When we're being tempted, we don't a lot of times. No, we don't.
Think what the consequences. Just one.
Yeah.
Let alone the fourfold or whatever that could come.
Yeah.
Well, David said his own son's kind of did. He would say fourfold.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, he did kind of.
Sixfold.
Yeah. Fourfold. Oh boy. Yeah, he could have. Yeah, a lot of times we don't think of the consequences.
God took so much from Job when he didn't do anything to deserve it. So.
Right.
Yeah.
But in that times of temptation, we're not thinking right. We just don't think right.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we got to flee. We got to get away from it. Now we can start to think right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Also, the result of his being tempted, his sin there was that the Lord was displeased.
Mm-hmm.
As bad as the other things are, to have God displeased with you is not a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, all right, let's pray and we'll be closing here. Father, thank you again for your grace and your mercy and how great we have the forgiveness through the blood of Jesus Christ. What an incredible thing. And I pray that you'd continue to bless us in our journeys of faith, that we'd learn from David and understand when we're tempted to sin that there's great consequences to it. So, Lord, I pray that you'd just help us. And whether it's a trial like David had with Saul after him, that we'd not lift our hand against the Lord's anointed, or it's a temptation like he faced with Bathsheba. All these things that, in the one way we saw David being so honorable and the other so wretched. And Lord, any one of us can be that way. So forgive us, help us, and may our morning service be to your glory. We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, my dear ones. All right.